And now for some authentic Native American music. As I'm playing this song here, I want you all to think about what you're thankful for in this life, all right?
Creator, you know, ask for help and rise up, you know, above all your obstacles in life. Go forward, make it happen.
Okay, guys, welcome back to the Grimerica Show. We're going to be chatting with Chris Parish a little bit later, also known as Supaman. Native hip-hop artist, powwow dancer, all-around great guy. It was a great chat. You guys will really enjoy it. But first, as always, Graham, don't say it's not a synchronicity Dunlop. How's it going, buddy?
Hey, I'm doing well. I'm doing good. Yeah, lots of synchronicities.
That was painful, eh, to get through the first, like, 3 minutes there. It took us, like, four tries.
I know, that's not usually
the way.
Not
even the first 30 seconds.
I think you're nervous about your man crush on Supaman here.
I'm nervous. There you go. I'm nervous about Red sneezing into the mic, I think.
Yeah, hey,
we've got... sorry, guys.
Red Pill Junkie here
noise,
as well.
It's RPJ.
Yeah.
Because I probably won't edit it out.
How's it going, Red?
Like you guys have mentioned, you know, I'm not too great, you know, physically speaking, you know, I'm suffering from a cold. But on the other hand, I'm really excited to listen to that episode with Supaman because ever since Darren sent me links to his music on YouTube, I was really amazed and excited about this cultural manifestation of which I was unaware of, you know, this existence of Native American hip-hop artists and how they are using appropriating hip-hop. And I think, you know, hip-hop is a form of art that is all about empowering the powerless, you know? And I think that's something that is much needed in the Native American communities in which they need to regain their respect and their pride for their, you know, incredible, you know, wonderful traditions and culture, you know. So that's why I'm really, really interested to listen to this episode, and also because of that Mysterious Universe article I think I wrote a couple of months back, in which talked about, you know, these problems of suicides that you know, has been a problem in Native American reservations for quite a while, but now it's been, you know, like coinciding or being mixed with this thing about Slenderman, you know, this new meme or this new, like, urban myth. And I remember writing how I thought that the only way to counter this negative influence will be, you know, like a cultural manifestation that will have to happen from within these societies, these reservations, you know. And I really think that Supaman and the other Native American hip-hop artists are the answer, you know, are the answer to this problem.
Yeah, he's also, you know, he's been in the powwow community for a while too, so he's also a dancer, and he's led in that way as well. And he talks about his helping the kids with, you know, addiction and alcoholism and suicide and stuff.
Suicide prevention.
He's really one of these guys that, you know, it's all about the community and being positive and being a role model and, you know, speaking as a voice for his community. So it's really interesting.
That is 100% fantastic.
Yeah, it's really good. So, and he's just like a super positive, nice guy, like really, you know, really genuine heart.
Yeah, well, and sorry.
No, it just crosses over with so many of other guests too. They're artists or musicians or healers, or there's so much talk about being heart based.
And he almost maxed out the synchronicity machine.
Oh really? Oh, now I can't really wait to listen to this.
Yeah. Now stay tuned.
Yeah, well, I got a couple other synchronicities.
Do you?
Yeah.
Well, so let's do this first. Hey, this happened last time. What did it turn out to be?
It's your tablet. The cord from your tablet there. There, it's going now.
Son of a bitch.
Looks like you're gonna have to push.
God,
I don't like that. You got the time.
I feel that my ears are being abducted.
Yeah.
Is that loud on your end?
Yeah.
Oh, that's because the fucking aux end is cranked. Sorry, Red. It's not loud on our end.
Anyways, you have requested, Darren, that we try a different type of quote. So I've got here a quote, and this is from...
Not a UFO quote?
This is a Native Elder quote.
That's the UFO music.
That's okay. Okay. It's kind of a book. It's okay. From... it's a quote from the Star Knowledge Conference in Sundance. So I figured...
I'm listening.
Okay, all right. So Deer Man commented that we have brought these imbalances on ourselves. The red race has responsibility for the land, but cannot do so because of herbicides, acid rain, and underground nuclear testing. Spirit told Deer Man that the other races were to follow the red way of life too, but have lost it. The outermost circle is the Star Nations. The Star Nations are here to help us. The Earth was out of balance and is rebalancing its tilt. We have to help the Earth come back into balance. Time, as you know it, is coming to an end, sooner than you think. There will not be cars or TVs. He said that the grandfathers taught him that we are coming to the end of the fourth world. We are about to enter the fifth world. This concurs with similar Hopi prophecies. It will take 9 worlds before we get to the spirit world. The adopted son of Grandfather Titus, keeper of the Hopi prophecy tablets, Roy Littleson, was scheduled to speak on behalf of his grandfather.
Well done.
Yeah, really interesting.
That was pretty good, actually. I just realized how fucking sick I was about hearing about UFOs.
Oh.
Just kidding, buddy.
Yeah, well, that
seriously
hurt.
Though, I would like to hear feedback, other people's feedback. Yeah, one, I think I like change it up.
Yeah, it can be another quote. That's fine.
And then it gives. Are you okay with it? You did another one. How'd you like it, Red?
I liked it. You know, I think that most UFO quotes that Graham has picked up for this space so far, it's with regards to people, you know, in authority positions, how saying that the UFO phenomenon is real, you know, and how, yada, yada, yada. Okay, I get it, you know, we all get it. It's important for having these sorts of persons, you know, speak up, you know, and have this testimony. But at the same time, you know, I want to go beyond that. You know, my interest in the UFO phenomenon goes beyond that. Oh, well, there's all these, you know, advanced craft flying in the air. Who knows where the hell they come from? Okay, yeah, but what else? You know, and this quote, I think that it's more, it explores different ground, I think.
Yeah, it's deeper. Yeah.
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 Dun, 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 dun. Now,
speaking of Red,
sorry, Red.
I want a good score on a synchronicity. If Graham reads it out, then Darren might give it to me. Hey, don't you please read it low? Yeah, yeah.
Should we give a little shout out, speaking of synchronicities, to our
coffee major?
Coffee major.
I can't remember what I rated it. Did I tell him I'd bump it up?
Well, you told him you'd bump it up because I was bitching about your rating because he saw Moai right when he heard James Matheson say Moai.
Oh, Dave, yeah, that's
Dave
right.
Matheson,
oh,
Dave.
Dave Matheson. Sorry, Dave. I've got a synchronicity from James Nation here, so that's why.
What did I rate it last time?
And yeah, that was... obscenely low. The
yeah,
last
exactly.
Time.
And you're saying,
wasn't
oh,
like
how 7. Many times 4, does he drive by the
wasn't
Moai?
It like 7.42 or something.
No, yeah, maybe, but it was worth more than that.
No, okay, well, add a point to it.
Anyways, he gave us some maps and he gave us some feedback on all social media platforms explaining that it really was within a second or two. So we want to say thank you for all the feedback.
What did I give him? I can't remember.
I think it was a 7.42, but okay, it's more than that.
I'll make it a 9.
9? Okay. Well, I have a similar type one.
No.
And yes. No, not for me personally. Okay. I've had lots of little ones like this, but this is from another listener. And who's it from? Well, you didn't even put this. Well, Darren, you didn't put. You sent it to me.
Oh, is that the Facebook one?
There's nobody on. So this is from an anonymous person on Facebook.
It's from Will.
From Will.
Will L.
Will L.
And he sent it in like less than an hour ago.
Wow, this is like real time shit here. So hello, I have a neat synchronicity for you. I live in the great state of Oklahoma. Was driving through a little town in the northwest part of our state whilst listening to a radio show on public radio. Sorry to hear that.
Whilst. Why wouldn't you listen to the Grimerica show? That's what I want to know.
And it's called the Prairie Home Companion. Right as they mentioned the Indian princess Minnehaha on the show, I drove over Minnehaha Creek in Canton. See, that's I like those ones.
It's kind of tying in with our show tonight at the same time. Yeah. And we were talking about Oklahoma in the interview.
Right. So, maybe he was listening.
Live?
Yeah.
Is he calling us public? Are we the public radio?
No.
Okay. Well, there's a extenuating circumstances. I'm going to give it an 8.7.
Wow. That's pretty good. Okay.
So now you know it, folks. If you're live listeners, you get a higher rate on synchronicity. So tune in.
Subscribers get higher ratings too.
We'll talk about how to subscribe to the show a little later. So here's one from a local dude who's playing in a band actually coming up. And he says, this
Graham's
is from James.
Graham's
going to
sing for him on Halloween.
No, I'm not singing. I don't sing unless I'm in my car or the shower.
Well, maybe you could just put a shower cap on.
I have some personal stories about shower caps that I won't go into.
Oh, come on. Come on, you look like Poindexter with your new glasses. I just love them.
Hey, buddy.
Wow, dang.
Hey, buddy. Hope all is well. Okay, this weekend, a close friend and I were having all kinds of crazy mind reading and different types of synchros. We would just laugh and think that we must be old souls and just know each other really well. But check this out. We go for Chinese food, and as we were leaving, I say to her, hey, let's see how crazy our fortunes are going to be. I bet they're going to be totally right. So she laughed at me and shrugged it off, and I said, too late, I've already manifested it. So we get in the car and open the plastic wrappers of our fortune cookies. Before we crack them open, I stop her and say, wait, let's synchronize the cookies. And I put my fortune cookie together with hers like they were kissing each other. And then we open the cookies and the fortunes are exactly the same. What the fuck? Crazy shit.
That's interesting.
And then he says, P.S., the Mike Hawk comment from your story about the Red Tail Hawk story was fucking hilarious. Hawk, 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 hawk.
Jesus.
He says, take it easy. Hope to see you guys at a show sometime. Trade me for a t-shirt for a nice donation. So anyways, he's playing at King's Head this coming weekend, which is the weekend this episode will come out.
Well,
and
you should
then,
have a t-shirt for a show.
Yeah, I know. And then at Morgan's
all
on Halloween.
All these t-shirts are going to be gone and we want to make a dime because they're all pro bono.
Anyways, he says he might help us out with some audio gear too. So he says, take it easy, man. The show is great. That's from James. So thanks, buddy.
Thanks, James. That's actually pretty common. I've had the same fortune.
I've had
two fortune cookies in a row because, you know, they give you like 6 or 7. And I've got the same fortune twice in a row. And it wasn't a synchronicity. I was like, huh, fucking getting lazy.
Yeah, but you didn't kiss your cookies together.
I could have.
That's a little different.
Is it?
Yeah. It is.
I say it's unaffected. I'll give it a 6. Sorry, James. I like it, but I think fortune cookies are made in shitty factories and they've only got a couple of fucking buckets to pick up. I think in any box of fortune cookies, there's probably only like a dozen different fortunes.
No, there's way more than that. I keep them and I do my lottery tickets with the numbers on the back.
How often do I get fortune cookies?
I got a bowl full of them at home.
Right now?
I order Chinese food like every...
So open them all up.
2 weeks or a month. Okay, I'll do that as an experiment. That's I'll open insane. Them all bring up them and here. I will no, tell no, you, no, I haven't no, had a repeat no, no, fortune. No, 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 I haven't had one since. Here. I will show you all here. The tickets.
You bring them here. I want them to come out of the wrapper in the igloo.
Okay.
I don't trust you.
Okay, I'll bring them next time.
You're sketchy okay. science.
I every time I order Chinese food at okay. least once a month.
If you bring 10 cookies in here, I will contest that at least. Two will be the same.
I'll bring more than 20 and there will be no duplicates.
Ooh, what's
because
the wage?
Because there hasn't been any yet.
What's the wage you're going to be? We can't decide this by ourselves.
Yeah, well, that's okay. The wager can be talked about when we get feedback.
Yeah. So you guys tell us what we should bet. This could be the biggest bet in the history of Grimerica.
There's no like whipped cream on naked bodies like they, I'm they not, requested on Twitter either.
I'm not as fond of you as Jackson is. Jackson. I'd like to see you put more clothes on right now. Like,
so, Red, we should talk about this.
I liked it better when we were non-local.
I want to change the topic here.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So, big shout out to our first guest of Grimerica, Efrain Palermo. And, Red, you wrote an article. I want to talk about your article here. But I wanted to read this email from Efrain, and then we can talk about it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. How does it feel to be editor of the Grimerica Facebook page, Red?
Oh, the power is intoxicating. Okay, well,
let's talk about that after I read this here.
Okay.
So, hey, guys, NASA is going to make a major Mars announcement. NASA will detail a major science finding from the agency's ongoing exploration of Mars during a news briefing on Monday. He says that the James Webb Auditorium at NASA headquarters in Washington, the event will be broadcast live on national television. The skinny is that they are going to announce the relationship of dark stains to water on Mars, which is exactly what my SEEPS paper detailed in 2001. Richard Holguin was working with me on my paper at the time, and he wants to interview me on this radio show, The Other Side of Midnight, tomorrow night. If you get a chance, read my paper. And if you can, check out the NASA announcement. So, of course, we were talking about this. When it comes out, we should tweet it with a link to our initial
Grimerica episode. I've tweeted it out a bunch of times.
Yeah.
Yeah,
absolutely. But I think there's a deeper phenomenon here that...
You would.
Yeah, it's not a phenomenon, but...
I read Efrain's paper.
Efrain?
I didn't refrain from reading Efrain's paper. I read it. That was in the beginning when we read everything and did extensive research and... I remember that was the, I think that I had a thing of questions typed out and everything. Like, yeah. I had like 15 questions all typed out.
Yeah.
I was in my living room.
Yeah.
And you were in your living room.
That's right. Non-local. The way you prefer it. Anyways.
I hurt your feelings? I'm sorry.
Anyways,
too much?
This is like why we do the show, right? Exactly. Like, look at this. We give Efrain a platform, right? He hadn't, mm-hmm. he had done his own podcast, but he waited years. This is the epitome of what we would like to happen on Grimerica, right? People talk about the research or whatever. We give them a platform, non-judgmental. They get a voice. And then look what happens, right? His shit comes to fruition like 14 years later.
Efrain is
he's on cloud nine.
Cloud nine right now. Absolutely.
Well, not really, because so far he hasn't received the credit from NASA that he rightly deserves. I think the only person who has talked to mainstream media and directly credit him, you know, with this finding is Robert Subrin, the founder of the Mars Society, you know, who spoke with CNN and he mentioned how, you know, this new, so quote-unquote, new announcement from NASA wasn't so new because, you know, people, but if Efrain and his colleagues, I think the other was Jill English and Harry Moore, if I'm not mistaken, were the guys who wrote a paper which was submitted to the Mars Society, I think, in 2001, you know, in August, I think, of 2001 in Stanford University, you know.
You mentioned Efrain?
Yes, he directly mentioned Efrain.
Do you have the? I want to play. I want to get that audio.
There's a quote a link to that is in an interview at the bottom of my Daily Grail article. You know, it's there.
The one you just
updates.
Wrote. Hello.
What? So, yes.
The one you just wrote tonight.
No, I wrote it yesterday.
Oh, I just seen it today.
Oh well.
Well, I'll click on that. I'll play that audio in this episode. Or you guys might have already heard it. I might have started the show with it. Or I'll play it right now.
Robert Zubrin is the president of the Mars Society, and he joins us from Boulder, Colorado, to talk about this announcement. Robert, this is an exciting day, but we've known that water existed on Mars for quite some time. We still don't know exactly where it all is or where it all went. But in your view, what is the major announcement NASA made?
Well, what's really new here is, first of all, they've confirmed earlier insights of this kind. We had one as early as 2001 by Palermo et al. And in 2011, but now this is really confirmed.
So congrats, Efrain, and great news.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting how, you know, it's evidence of how armchair researchers, amateur researchers, you know, can nonetheless make a huge contribution to our knowledge, you know, to science or maybe history, you know. I wanted to equate Efrain with someone like Graham Hancock, who's always been, you know, constantly attacked. One of the most common attacks Hancock receives is the fact that they call him a pseudo archaeologist, and he's always, you know, reminding them, you know, I've never claimed to be an archaeologist. I'm a journalist who explore archaeological topics, you know. But no, you know, in academia, if you don't have the right credentials, you don't get to speak. You know, that's exactly what happened to John Anthony West when he wanted to have this big debate, you know, in, I think it was the American Egyptology Society or something like that, about his and Robert Schock's, you know, theory of the age of the Sphinx. And the only guy who got permission to talk was shocked, because he has a doctorate in geology. You know, yeah, what I mean? Yeah. How sick is that? You know, how we're still viewing, you know, people or judging them in based on their high or low education. You know, what I mean, Albert Einstein was fucking working in a Swiss patent office, you know, when he wrote the paper that changed the world 100 years ago, you know.
Yeah, and it's not like Efrain didn't put a lot of work in. He yes. put in hours and hours and days of mapping the whole of Mars before there was even like Wi-Fi, right? We were talking about how hard it was to download pictures.
It was like one line at a time, like,
yeah. And he was
like an old I pictured like an old laser printer, remember, like,
yeah, and he was using old technology. I mean, the resolution that the global Mars surveyor, which is the probe that arrived orbiting Mars since, I think, 1997, is, you know, several orders of magnitude worse than the resolution of the newer probes, the newer satellites that NASA possesses, than the ones that they used to take out these new photographs, which, by the way, were shown to the film director Ridley Scott 2 months prior to this big announcement on Monday. You know, the guy who was shooting or maybe finishing post-production of his new movie, The Martian, you know, he knew that there was flowing water on Mars 2 months before the rest of the world. You know, how's that for a conspiracy theory?
How's that okay?
Well, you know, since there's always going to be people with inside information.
Movie people?
Yeah, sometimes, you know, I mean, celebrities are people who rub elbows with people on the top.
Yeah,
should just be public knowledge right away.
Well,
especially for Efrain.
I will say there has to be a proper investigation. You know, they have like let's get back to the infamous issue of the Roswell slides. You first need to study the thing, put all your ducks in a row, and then you go on with the big announcement.
Yeah, so you wrote an article on Daily Grail?
Yeah, I think I titled it Water on Mars, Score One for Amateur Research.
Nice. You know,
I think that saying how disappointing it is, well, I'm paraphrasing myself here, how disappointing it is that on the one hand, NASA is always struggling to get the public excited about space exploration because that's how they get funds for their programs and their missions, you know? If there wasn't any public interest, they wouldn't get nada. I mean, and here is this guy, you know, Efrain, who is making great use of the information they freely distribute, which is, like you said, public information paid by the American taxpayers, and he managed to make this great discovery, which at that time NASA interpreted those black streaks as dust slides. You know, They didn't consider the possibility that it was water related, but that was like something that Efrain, you know, who doesn't have any degrees in geology, arrived. You know, using only plain common sense. I think that the problem is maybe one of the problems. Let me see what you guys think. I think one of the problems is that Efrain got, for better or for worse, got associated with Richard Hoagland. We managed to give them a lot of help at the beginning. You know, I think he gave them good pointers on how to proceed next and then to submit this paper. But the problem is that Hoagland by now is, you know, considered to be a woo-woo guy. You know, he's always the kind of people who are finding like Bigfoot or crabs or squirrels on Mars and God knows what else, you know. And maybe that's the reason why NASA doesn't take armchair researchers looking into Mars seriously anymore.
That's a tough one. I don't know.
I know.
Yeah, that's got a point.
I mean, it's not that I want to belittle Hoagland. I think that at the beginning he was making very interesting.
This was already past. Would this have been after the Face on Mars second pictures came out? Remember when it came out the second time and it seemed like pretty obvious it was just some rocks?
Well, but
if you believe.
They put a man on the moon.
I still think that the Face on Mars is interesting, you know, despite the evident erosion and the lack of, you know, easily perceivable, human facial features. You know, I still think that the face is an interesting geological anomaly that should be looked further into, you know, because it has bilateral symmetry and several things. And the fact that, you know, people like Hoagland found all these, you know, alleged alignments and correlations between the face and other features in
Sidonia.
The Sidonia region, exactly. You know, maybe some people will say, well, you know, obviously he found those correlations because, you know, the human mind, that's what we do, you know, we find patterns, even when there aren't, you know, that's the basis of this phenomenon called pareidolia, you know, that you find, you know, the face of, I don't know, Jesus in your cereal bowl or whatever, but
or a UFO.
Or a UFO or anything that you can come up with. You know, you show someone. I think that Mars by now is like a planet size Rorschach test for humanity. You know, you see what you want to see. But having said that, I still think there are things that Hoagland and others, you know, propose with regards to Mars and also with regards to the moon that shouldn't be discarded just yet. You know, I mean, there is probably a few gems hidden inside all that pile of manure.
I agree, and NASA doesn't really help themselves out when they're airbrushing, you know, when supposedly they're airbrushing Mars and the Moon pictures, and they lose the Moon pictures from, you know, decades ago. You know, yeah. They've admitted that they've, how can you lose stuff like that? So, I mean, you know, this is ripe for conspiracy, you know?
Well, conspiracy or, you know, basic government incompetence.
No, not with that.
Well, we could have a roundtable about the so-called secret space program. You know, that will be a fun episode for Grimerica.
Yeah, well, Adam Curry's going to the secret space program conference in Austin at the end of the month.
Oh, nice.
You could just walk there.
Red, how far are you away from Austin, Red?
I'm very far from Austin. You guys keep thinking that I'm just, you know, near to the border, that I can, you know, throw a rock to the Rio Grande, you know, from my window. No, bitches. I'm in the center of the Mexico, and Mexico happens to be quite a big country, you know. Thank you very much.
There you go, Darren.
Well, you could maybe take a bus.
Oh, yeah.
It's closer in Minneapolis.
18 hours. Ah, well, yeah. Well, you had to go there, right? Huh?
No, let's not. Let's talk about how you posted this article on our Facebook page. Because this is a way we could probably... We don't really have marketing strategy or anything. It's really word of mouth, our podcast here. But there is ways that people can help us out, right? And Darren's got... some ways that you can actually help us out with Facebook, right, Darren? Do you want to talk about that?
I suppose. I was planning on saying Red was an editor. Oh, I wasn't gonna be, but I added a few other people too, and right. I suppose if people want to get on board, and
can anyone post on the Grimerica Facebook page?
Yeah, but it only goes into the feed if they post as an editor.
Well, I think that should change. I think that, you know, Greg Bishop has his Radio Misterioso page, and it's something of a... Well, I see that everyone can post there, and it stays there in the.
Oh, really? I'll see if I can do that. I don't mind making that.
Same with UFO updates, you know. So check it out.
Maybe there's a setting. I've just kind of finally started poking around in there to see what you can do.
I think it will be a cool feature for the Grimerica community. You know, it will help us strengthen, you know, the community of listeners and show them that they can contribute to the Grimerica effort, you know.
Absolutely. If I can find a way, I'll set it up like that. And I'll take on a few people as editors so they can be commenting and chatting in other people's pages as a Grimerica show as well, if they wanna use Grimerica as a platform to maybe talk about fringe stuff they don't want to talk about on their Facebook account.
Yeah, exactly. So. Yeah. And plus, that's easier for them than
just
telling
go,
a friend,
just
right?
Like, it's hard to tell somebody out or being an asshole.
Yeah, you'd have
with
to be respectful.
We gotta,
yeah.
I suppose we should do some vetting.
Some sort of like.
We know who our hardcores are, though.
Yeah. I haven't seen any sign of any of that risk at all so far.
Yeah, you should only enforce vetting and censorship when someone, you know, goes and makes something.
When someone makes it happen.
Yeah.
No, it makes a big no-no, like, I don't know, posting insults or something like that, you know?
Pictures of Graham and fucking whipped cream.
Yeah, Graham is a big boy. He can take it, you know? But you know what I mean.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah.
Agreed. We're not a police state. We'll give
exactly.
You guys. So if you're interested in that, shoot me an email and I'll get you set up. Because me and Graham are both too lazy to Facebook, so we'll let you guys Facebook for us.
I'm scared.
Graham's too scared to Facebook.
I'm not lazy. I'm scared.
And that's just another way you can support the show. Of course, we've got more traditional ways as well. If you head on over to grimerica.ca/support, you can see all the different options there where you can either subscribe monthly or throw a one-time donation. Help us pay the bills.
Yeah, it's going to get cold in the igloo.
Yeah, help us pay the heat. The igloo has been getting colder and colder. We need to buy a heater, and we need to heat this motherfucker through a -30-degree Canadian winter.
Oh.
So yeah, help keep us ad sponsor paywall free. Everything here is free, and you guys can pay us as you see fit. If you can't afford to support us monetarily, you can always sign up for the newsletter, sign up some other people for the newsletter, sign up as many people as you can for the newsletter. And if you don't want to do that, then you can just tell your friends about this show and review us. Grimerica.ca/iTunes. Spam the shit out of Graham. Graham@Grimerica.com.
Right on, buddy.
And that's all the different ways to support our value for value model.
And of course, reviews on iTunes really helps as well, I believe. Kind of changes the algorithm.
Yeah. Sometimes it seems like the value for value model is not working, and then you get a little spurt and it's like, oh, yeah. And then we always got our faithfuls, right? Like we've got, you know, it's our subscribers are what really pay the bills.
Yeah. And if our subscribers end up, like if their credit cards expire and they get disconnected, we're not going to come after you for a new
what the hell happened,
so
man?
You'll have to
people have canceled their subscriptions and then like 4 months later it'll pop back up again. So it's just they've realized that they got a new credit card or something like that.
Yeah.
But if you're on one of those $5 a monthers, you don't want to lose that one because those are extinct. That's the only Canadian option.
$5 a month?
No, it's not even an option anymore.
Are you still giving away email addresses with
nobody's asked for one for a while. We haven't talked about it. Maybe that's why. On a monthly of $5 or more, it comes with the Grimerica email address.
Yeah.
Well, supplies last. Yeah. Big thanks to Wayne Darnell, too. He does a website for us. Justin, for doing the newsletter.
Look, I do want to throw something out there as well, speaking of donations, because we talked about it in the last show, so I want to keep this message out there a little bit, but...
The meme?
Yeah, if you're donating to a level of like $420 or $432, then you can pick a guest.
Oh, yeah, $432, that's what we said it was going to be. I always forget about that.
Pick a guest, and you can come on the show and help us out with the chat.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we'll just, you know... We'll try not to keep track on our end.
Yeah, we're hoping you guys can just do the math and we'll just take your word for it.
So, Red, anything else that you got going on right now besides the healing from your stuffed up nose?
Yeah, well, you're a Reiki master, right? So you can send me like healing energy.
I could do that, actually.
Well, let's put that to the test, bitch. But
you aren't going to Reiki?
Getting back to the water on Mars, you know, I just found an article from a Mexican magazine telling that apparently because of the international treaty signed by the United States and other countries in 1967, it is not permitted to go near the water on Mars, if there was any, you know, at the time. You know, that maybe that's one of the reasons why, you know, the rovers are always exploring what one thinks is the most boring parts of the Martian landscape, you know?
So because apparently they're not allowed to find water.
Apparently they're not allowed to go near the water for risk of contaminating the water supplies or the water deposits, you know, and that's a problem that I think they haven't solved yet, how to properly sterilize the equipment and maybe in the future the personnel who will set foot on Mars and explore the planet without risking the possible indigenous population of Martians, be there, you know, microbial or whatever, you know, or unless we are really planning on terraforming Mars.
I know, but it must be tempting not to stock that pond, eh?
Just fuck them. Just roll right in there, America.
Well, I Robert Subrin, you know, the guy who spoke so highly, well, who mentioned Efrain on CNN, you know, I think he's the kind of the person who will say that water will be indispensable for any future manned missions, because the astronauts will use them for everything from, you know, drinking it, using it for extracting oxygen, and also maybe even, you know, converting it into rocket fuel to for the trip back.
Wow.
Rockman.
So that it's an this is an interesting thing that it's probably going to be talked further in the not so distant future. You know how people will start to say, okay, so what are we going to do with Mars? What are we going to do with the water we just found on Mars? What should humanity do with this planet? And how that would even change if NASA announced, you know, next year in 2016, guess what? We just found, you know, undisputable proof that undisputable proof that there is life on Mars.
I know what they can do.
What happens next?
I know what they can do. There's probably oil. We'll drill for oil on that motherfucker.
Well, yeah, I know. You're the kind of person who will have no qualms in shooting Bigfoot, so obviously you will say, ah, fuck the Martian microbes.
Martian oil is probably the shit.
Let's get them Martian oil, boys.
Yeah. I know what they're going to do. Ignore it, just like they did with the face in Sidonia.
Sedona?
Sidonia?
Was it Sidonia? It's Sidonia, Mars, and Sedona, Phoenix.
Yeah. No, Sedona. Yes. Sedona, Arizona. Sorry to all our listeners in the Phoenix area.
It's all the same.
Yeah, that's interesting. So you think that next year, is that a prediction from you, Red, that next year they're going to find alien life on Mars then?
I think that by now it wouldn't surprise me in the least, you know? Yeah. I mean, if you want to put on your conspiracy hat for a minute, I think that this is the kind of preparation, you know, slow adaptation of the public to the paradigm shift of finding life on another planet, you know, to go in bit by bit, you know, and slow baby steps, and then, oh, well, you know, we just found, I don't know, organic compounds on Mars. Oh, well, here you know, now we found, you know, the evidence that Mars used to have a shitload of water in the past. Oh, well, how do you know? Now we found there still is flowing water on Mars. And, you know, maybe next year, hey, how do you know? Now we found some Martian microbes. You know, and by then, a lot of people will say, yo, meh, you know, and keep watching, you know, Netflix for some, you know, reruns of Breaking Bad or whatever, you know, because by then it wouldn't be such a shock. But I tell you, if in 1967 or in 1971, which I think was the year they launched the Viking missions of Mars, if they had found this evidence of flowing water, man, it would have been, you know, top news, you know, those guys would have earned the Nobel Prize, no questions, you know.
Well, nowadays half the population probably thinks that fucking Men in Black is real.
They are, Darren.
Well, they are real, man. Didn't you read Robbie Graham's excerpt that he posted on his new webpage, Silver Screen Saucers? You know, it was the page that he launched with the publishing of this newly released book, Silver Screen Saucers, which deals with all these, you know, interesting correlations between Hollywood and the UFO phenomenon. How there seems to be people, maybe in the government, who have tried to get a hold and influence the pop culture perception on UFOs. And there is an article, an excerpt on Robbie's page dealing with that 90s TV series Dark Skies, you know, which used to be running, you know, on pair with the X-Files. Unfortunately, I think that the X-Files stole all of their thunder, and that's why it got canceled by the first season. But nevertheless, it became something of a cult.
Well, it could have been a little too close to the truth.
Oh, well, there in this.
No, listen, I'm waiting for the new X-Files.
Dude, listen, in this excerpt in question, Bryce Zabel, I hope I'm pronouncing.
Yep. Yeah, Bryce Zabel, yeah.
He talks about how in the wrap-up party that they had, you know, when they were going to view the live broadcast of the series's pilot, you know, that means that nobody except a few honchos in Hollywood and on the network had seen the pilot yet. A guy approached him and he told him, you know, point blank, we've seen your pilot, and we think that you've come quite close to the truth, something like that, you know. And then they had a meeting with this guy, and another people who claimed to be working for naval intelligence, and they were telling them, you know, that they could help them, you know, put a lot of, you know, inside info about UFOs in their show. But and that's when how you, now you have to visit Robbie's webpage and read the rest.
All right. Yeah, I saw that series a little while back, and it was kind of hard to find, and I heard something recently that it was just re-released on some network, so I'll try and link to it. That's the TV series Dark Skies.
Yeah,
and
Darren, you can find it.
Darren can't ignore the fact that Men in Black is a real phenomenon. Who knows what they are?
I didn't say that. I think you totally railroaded my fucking point and just...
There are different types of...
What was your point?
I don't remember anymore. Fuck you guys. Couldn't have been that important. Yeah. I suppose we should jump into our chat with Supaman.
Yeah.
I'll dump his new, that's a bad word, but I'll cut in his newest song there, his new single Why right now before the interview. I think I'll just play the whole song, eh?
Should
I?
Sure, man.
Yeah, I'll just play the whole song. Sure. And then after that, we'll jump into our chat with Supaman. So thanks for coming, Red. Enjoy.
Yeah, anytime, guys.
Enjoy the interview, and we'll see you guys in the outro.
Why don't you help your brother when you see him fall? Why do we act like God don't see it all? Why do we call them black, them white, them Asians and use labels? Now that's racism.
I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. Yo, why? I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. Yo, why? I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii.
Why is there innocent people locked up for life? While some people can't say nothing nice. Why do we always got a question with all of the means? And why won't you follow your dreams? Tell me why. The night when you took my dad, why'd you let me see my grandpa cry? And tell me why. And why do you choose to hide? Even though you was born to fly. And tell me why. And why don't we turn from all the hate? Why do I keep on wrecking these fat beats? And teachers don't make more than professional athletes. And why? And why? And why? And why? And why?
I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. No, why? I don't want no hawaii.
Why?
I don't want no hawaii. No, why?
All right, tonight we got Christian Parish here, aka Supaman. He's got a new single out and a video. Basically a native rap artist, and it's called Why, and he's got a new album coming out called Illuminative. I want to mention his albums because he's already got three of them. Gorilla is his latest one before that, Deadly Pens and Crow Hop. And he's also a very accomplished powwow dancer, kind of at the championship level. So we got lots to talk to him about. He's from down in Montana, just south of us in Calgary. So welcome to the show, Supaman.
Hey, glad to be here. How you brothers doing?
We're good, yes. Enjoying the last few bits of summer before winter turns over. But I suppose you know all about that, being so far north.
Yeah, you betcha.
So I got to say, I hadn't really heard too much about you until about, I want to say 3 weeks ago. And I came home from work and my wife and my daughters were jamming out to your new single Why on YouTube, and it was just starting. And I started watching the video, and I mean, it's been so long since I've got this from a song, but it's like about halfway through the song, I just kind of started getting those shivers down my spine. And I was just like, wow, this is fucking amazing.
You can't bug me anymore for that.
No, and then I got to talk to this guy. Within a few minutes, I had tracked you down on Twitter and was trying to set it up, because I just think that the approach your music has taken, and I really think you're about to turn a corner, and it's just it's just a nice mix of, I mean, it's the hip hop I want to listen to. You know what I mean? Like when I was younger, I used to love that gangster rap stuff, but nowadays, like the words have so much more meaning, I suppose, than your average rap song.
Right on. I appreciate that. Yeah, thanks. I'm glad you came across the music and everything. So I appreciate that.
I think it's a missing part of pop culture now. Like you don't see a lot of, or I don't. I mean, and I'm not involved too much in the pop culture side. We're kind of in the alternative, you know, media and all that. I don't listen to a lot of like radio, but having that kind of native lyrics in a hip hop song, I think you're onto something there.
Yeah, yep, for sure. It's always good, to represent the culture, you know, in a good way. As natives, you know, we're already our traditions and our culture is positive. You know, it's all about family and community anyway. You know, so that's just a normal part of life, I think, to bring it into the music.
Is this something that you just done recently, or has it always been a part of your music?
It's always been a lyrical part, you know, the content-wise,
right,
has always been like that. And but doing it visually and kind of like mixing of the cultures, if you saw the videos, you saw me, you know, in my fancy dance, you know, outfit and dancing and using flutes, you know, and drums and stuff like that, doing looping. So that's kind of, I guess that's a little bit new, you know, maybe been doing that for about 5 years now. But that's kind of new, of putting the cultures together.
Yeah, it's it reminds me of, we've done a couple shows here where they're talking about some of the medicine wheels out here in Alberta and also in northern USA. And there's some real ancient sites here. We had a guy on who's been, you know, investigating these sites that, you know, he says are like 5,000-6,000 years old in the prairies. And that video just had that feel of those ancient sites, like you sitting in the grass and standing in the grasslands.
I showed a couple people,
there,
they're like, is this in Alberta?
Yeah, it really looks like it's in our backyard here.
Yeah, yep, that's right. Right on my res over there in Crow, that's where like everybody goes. That's right by Crow Fair. If you ever been to Crow Fair, that's just right up on the hill. But the campground is in the prairies there, so it was a perfect setting for that video at that time.
And I seen just recently you were getting some accolades from Snoop, so that's gonna be pretty rewarding. Like I remember listening to Snoop back in the day, and you must have been listening to it too. So I was wondering, how ironic it is that it's since you've taken this turn. Like I've listened to you talked about some other things where you talked about before, maybe you were straight up just doing gangster rap. And how interesting is it that now that you've started to bring your culture into it, now is when you're starting to get, you know, these accolades from people who were probably your idols coming up.
Yeah. It's like a big surprise and just like a real honor, you know, to see these, celebrities, I guess you could say, you know, sharing the video and just kind of like really blown away, you know, by the music and the visual, you know, that we put out there. Like there was Snoop, you know, there was Michelle Rodriguez from Fast and the Furious, the actress.
Oh, yeah.
And there was Lil Rob and, you know, MC Magic, some Latinos, and there was Team Backpack. They're a big site, you know, online. And let's see who else there. Oh, one of the the actor Ise Morales from La Bamba. He just shared it last night. So I was like, hey, all right, man, it's cool to, you know, be getting some love, you know, from like these big names, I guess, you know, especially like Snoop, you know, like, man, listening to his music growing up on it, you know, and just like know every lyric and, you know, and all of that. And for him to say, you know, check this out, this is dope, you know, and it's me, it's my music. It's like, oh, wow, you know, it's a great honor, you know, like trips me out.
So for some people, some of our listeners who might be hearing of you for the first time right now, could you like just kind of take us? Because, I mean, obviously it hasn't been an easy road or an overnight thing. Like, you've been at this for the better part of your life. I mean, can you kind of take us through how it started up and how you sort of got to where you are today?
Yeah, yeah. For all those listening, you know, if you've never heard of me, Supaman, native hip-hop artist from the Absaraga Nation here in Montana. I've been doing music, man, for a long time, maybe 15 plus years, and even started off traveling with Lightfoot, who was a native artist doing it way back when. You know, that's where I kind of got some learning tools, you know, about the business and, you know, performing and things like that. So I've been doing it, you know, for quite a long time, and just learned to do everything, you know, myself, basically doing beats, you know, production. I got like all my albums are pretty much all self-produced. You know, I make all the beats, do all the recordings, and even the graphic design. So I've just been pushing forward, you know, in Indian country, you know, in native countries, and reaching out, you know, to the youth, you know, working with suicide prevention programs, you know, alcohol and drug prevention programs, because my life is positive. You know, I'm a husband, I'm a father, you know, I never drank alcohol in my life. And so I'm just, you know, it's just normal life. And so I realized, like, doing music, like, this is, people are like, hey, you know, come over and talk to our kids. You know, you're a good influence, you're a good role model. You know, that's kind of was a learning experience for me, because I was just doing hip hop, and I just wanted to do something I really liked. I really enjoyed hip hop, the culture of hip hop. And I found out later that, hey, you know, it's a good tool to reach the people, you know, to have them listen to your messages about being, you know, who you are as a human being. And so just always pressing forward, you know, and making music. I had some albums out and won some awards, you know, the Native American Music Award, won the North American Indigenous Image Award, as well as Aboriginal People's Music Choice Award, and, you know, awards like that, especially even around the way here locally in Montana. I won some awards there, did a lot of freestyle battles, things of that sort, and just, you know, always, it's always been progression. You know, it's never been, you know, going down here, okay, time to go get a job and I'll go back to college. It's always been, you know, a rise and always building, you know, it's always continuous growth. And so made some albums and put it out. And just these past maybe 3 years have been probably the best with social media, you know, being the tool of promotion, you know. So a lot of people, a lot of natives and people are able to see my work, you know, online, and it's been a big old boost for me. So I'm just enjoying the ride.
Yeah, I bet. It's funny, like, I got to agree with without the advent of social media, there probably wouldn't even be a Grimerica show, or there might be there, but there probably wouldn't be more than 50 listeners.
Right. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
So I like, that's one of the things that's really intriguing, is that you're kind of putting your money where your mouth is, and you're spending, like, I've been reading these articles, you're spending some time, you know, talking to the kids, or you always make a point to stop by and talk to the up and coming native youth about, you know, the bright side. Because, I mean, if there's one thing, I'm assuming it's the same in south of the borders here, is that when you're growing up native, there's like, I don't know what to call it, but there's a certain amount of stigma and almost, you know, like racism towards natives in North America.
Yeah, yep, definitely. You know, just, you know, doing music and everything, I've learned, like, you know, that you have to become, you're just kind of put into a position of being an educator automatically. You know, when people listen to your music and you kind of cross that native line, you know, and where non-natives are listening to your music, you have to sort of just educate them. You know, you find yourself just like, oh, okay, these guys don't know about natives, or, you know, it's just, taught by Hollywood and, you know, different outlets like that over the years. And they have no clue, you know, of what natives been through. They have no clue of the true history of these lands, you know. And so you find yourself having to educate them, you know, and becoming not really an activist, but you become a voice, an automatic voice, you know, for your people, because they just don't know. And, you know, and they're ignorant to the struggles of what we've gone through and what we have to deal with, you know, with racism, you know, in this day. And so I embrace that, you know, myself. I embrace that because you just find it out, you know, and it just makes you more aware of the education system and the whole, especially down here in the States, you know, of white America, you know, the privilege of white, and everything was geared towards, you know, the white race, you know, all these years, and we're having to, you know, fight for our rights still. And so it's all a good journey, though, you know, all love, peace.
Isn't it funny how that seems to be like North American and not even North American specific? It's just like from the Mexican border up, and then the rest of the world, I mean, there's absolutely, you don't see, like, at least personally in my, what I've heard and seen, you see like zero of that in Europe or Australia or Asia and down in South America. Like, there's not that stigma. Like, to them, Native Americans are still kind of the way we look at Peruvian shamans,
right,
and things,
yeah,
like that.
It's more of an indigenous thing and less suppression, kind of. Is that what you mean, Darren?
Yeah, absolutely. That's what I think. Anyway, I'm wondering if you've noticed the same thing.
Yeah, I think so. Like, worldwide, the view of natives, you know, and indigenous people is it's different, you know, than it is over here in our own area. It's just, I know America's just ashamed, you know. They don't want people to know, you know, what they've done. They always want to kind of sweep under the rug. And so when they're exposed, you know, it just brings that.
It's a lot easier when we're savages, right? It's a lot easier for them to justify when we were just heathens.
Right, yeah. So it's still that way today, you know, but the voice of indigenous people is getting bigger, you know, and more non-natives are coming into the agreement and just the knowledge of, hey, this isn't right, you know, these indigenous people are, you know, were killed, slaughtered, and have gone through these things, and that's not right, you know, they're... not anti-government, but they're more along, you know, want the truth. You know, they want the truth revealed, which is a good thing.
Was there a point when you realized you were a voice of your people? Like, was there a point when you go, wow, like, okay, I'm being looked up to here, and I have to make an example? Like, was that a conscious shift, or did it just happen over a long period gradually?
It was early on, you know. Early on, I knew, you know, that that being positive and, you know, being drug and alcohol free was something good for the people, you know. Like, I just got it from the elders, you know. They're like, you know, they would come and say, you know, what you're doing is a good thing, you know. These young people out there need to hear what you're saying, because you're living it and you're walking it, and that's rare, you know. There's not a lot of people who have that platform, you know. So continue to do that and be mindful of the gifts that you have, you know. So you would tell me things like that. And so I knew that it was, you know, a responsibility, and that it was special. So I always kind of, you know, cater to that and be mindful of it, you know, along this journey of music and use it in a good way, you know. And I would always get it too, like through the inboxes and through the emails, you know. The young people would be like, hey, I saw you at the conference, you know, and I just want to tell you, I was way in the back, you know, with my friends, and I've been going through depression, and you know, nobody knows about it. But when you spoke, you know, I felt peace, and I felt inspired, you know, to continue on with life, because, you know, I was going to go commit suicide, you know, after this conference, and, you know, things like that. You hear stories, you know, in the background, and you don't even know who you're inspiring, you know, who's listening in these crowds of these youth conferences, of the people who are listening to the music online or what, you know. You never know what people are going through and what your music and what your words are doing, you know. It becomes real powerful when you hear stories like that, you know. They connect with you and they tell you, hey, this is what was going on, you know, and this is how you helped me. So when I hear that, it's just amazing.
Wow. Have you noticed an increase or a decrease with addiction and alcohol as far as being a problem?
It's always a struggle. You know, I think it's always a war. I don't know about increase or decrease, but I just know it's constant. You know, we're at constant battle, you know, with these things that are negative, these negative spirits of suicide and alcohol, drugs. It's always, you know, it's always present, you know, in every community that I go through. But I think online is becoming the native voice for youth is becoming stronger and bigger, you know, of being sober, being positive, nice. Being about the people, being about family. And so I don't want to say it's a trend, you know, but it's like it's the majority of native, you know, native values are becoming, you know, the majority that other people are seeing online. Like when you connect with natives from all over different reses, you're seeing that majority, you know, speak loud, louder than the negative. And so I think it's really influencing, you know, those factors, you know, who were on drugs and alcohol. And I think it's awesome, you know, that's the majority. And that most of the native artists who are getting, you know, props and praise are ones who are living a good life, you know, they're like positive.
Yeah, and I think it fits in a lot with our show as well, what we talk about here. We talk about ancient mysteries a lot and ancient peoples and maybe ancient civilizations that were around before, you know, before it's actually officially recognized in our culture. And a lot of times that we talk about native mythologies and you hear, you know, along with the spiritual growth of our culture as well, like the online movement, I think is also helping people become more mindful and more spiritual. And you hear people say things like go back to like, you know, the native roots or living off, like being more respectful to the land and living natural. And like, there's that whole positive spin of like, look at the way our indigenous cultures used to be so one with everything. Right. And I think that's, right. I think that's helping a lot.
Definitely. Yeah. It's like I said, the trend, you know, the majority, man, like it, everybody's being influenced by all of these positive people and like, you know, a lot of the celebrities, you know, the actors and actresses and things of that sort they're all the same way, you know, they're anti-pipeline, they're about Mother Earth, you know, they're walking the walk and it's great to see, you know, and I love that part of it.
So we also talk about you know, like the native mythologies and do you ever, like, did you grow up learning about some of your ancient myths, like of the star people? Like we've had somebody on
Artie Six Killer Clark,
who talks about all the people that she met who had, either sightings or encounters with strange craft, or they've openly talked about their own, you know, mythology of the star people. And yet we live in this culture of materialism and, in the West. I mean, do you ever think about the hypocrisy of that, or like the schizophrenic type of world we live in?
Yeah, definitely. It was, I had the privilege of going down to, Northern Cali just recently. And, it kind of tripped me out because that whole community of Nevada City was filled with a lot of people who, they had a lot of beliefs, you know, they were take a lot of beliefs, you know, from here and there. And there's a lot of, you know, they're into peyote and they're into the stars, astrology, and they're into, you know, all kinds of, you know, spirituality. They just kind of take from everything, you know, and they use it. They're so hungry for spirituality. And there was a dude there that was speaking at that show. His name was Chief Golden Light Eagle or something like that. But he was like talking about like aliens and stuff like that too himself, you know? And, but as far as, myself and my beliefs with the Ipsaloga and the Crow people, it's always been, you know, the creator, you know, the one creator who created us all, and our spirituality is kind of goes, back from there, from, you know, from fasting and praying and having that connection, you know, with him, to where, when we traveled, you know, when our people would travel and they would go to the mountains, and, you know, the medicine people, medicine men, they knew that there was power in those mountains, you know, and they would would ride to the village and say, "Oh, you young men, you know, you boys, these hills are powerful, these mountains are powerful. Go pray, go fast, go get your helpers, go get your power, and come back, you know, and help the people." And so the kids, you know, who are 10, 12 years old, these young men would go to these mountains. They would pray, you know, they would pray and fast. They wouldn't eat, and they would, you know, see visions. You know, they would get their power, and they would come back with helpers and help them with the people, you know, help the people. So that's kind of where I come from. You know, I come from that lineage of spirituality and where prayer is, you know, the main thing, main power.
We also talk about where creativity comes from a lot. We had another artist on recently who was a rock artist, but Kevin Estrella. And it's like people talk about this flow state or this meditative state where creativity comes from, like they just open up. So do you find that where does your creativity come from, and does your spiritual practice help with that? Like, do you connect the two together at all?
Yeah, definitely. Like that's top of it, you know. That's you can't have one without the other, you know, when it comes to making music and being creative. Like there's a few songs where I just got in, you know, and wrote them down. It was all silly, you know, and stuff like that, but they don't have that power, you know, and that tangible, you know, that power that's upon that song. You know, sometimes it's just whatever, it's your words, but the ones that I've had, you know, the most success with are the songs that I've prayed, you know, I've spent time in prayer, and I would ask the creator, you know, I would say, you know, help me. What do you want me to say? You know, what do you want me to say to the people? I'll say it, you know, let this be your song. Let this be your voice, you know, for them. And I would come up with these songs after prayer, you know, just spending time in his presence. You know, that's really important in my life, is not just from doing music, but just having a prayer life in itself to be able to function, you know, on earth. You know, I believe that everybody should have that, to where you go and you're in prayer time. And the more you're in prayer time, the less that you have distractions, you know, of this flesh, of, you know, our mind and whatever distractions, you know, your spirit man comes forth, and you're able to commune, you know, with the one who made us. And when you do that, when you connect with the creator, you know, this peace and this love, you know, comes upon you, and all the stress and worry, you know, that'll leave. And then you're able to, like, understand what life is about. You know, you're able to understand, like, hey, the most important things in life is to love one another, you know, and to love your family, and, you know, cherish the small moments in life, you know. And then you leave from prayer time with that knowledge, you know, that wisdom that came from the creator. And then you're like, bam, you're able to write, you know, with this knowledge and wisdom, and you're able to connect with the people, you know, like when you come out of prayer time and you go out into the world, you know, and on earth, and all you want to do is serve, you know, you want other people to be successful. It's not about you anymore. It's more about others, you know. And that's an important part of my everyday life. I try to make it an important part of my everyday life. So creativity, you know, that comes from that time. You know, that's where you get these ideas, these creative ideas, that just pop up into your head, you know, and you just like make them happen, and people are blown away by it. Like, it's like the looping, you know, that I did, that was actually a creative idea that was in my head for like 2 years. And then it just manifested, you know, it just came alive and it just took off, and it's really helped me in business and just what I do.
Yeah, it's interesting. And for people, like, it doesn't even have to be a religious thing necessarily, but that prayer practice would just connect it. It connects you with the moment as well. Right. And it's meditative, right? Like if you're concentrating on connection with whatever higher power you believe in, it's bringing you into the moment and, you know, being mindful of what's really going on right now.
Yeah, that's true.
I think that's the point, right? It just seems like most of the major religions now have been sort of hijacked. It's like everyone's talking about it, but no one's doing it anymore. And that's where I think that's where more like the the Native American and the Eastern, more East, far Eastern styles of their religion. I think, you know, it's just as much about how they've stuck with their practice of how they pray to the Creator, as opposed to, you know, okay, well, I read this Bible a bunch of times and I can read it by heart, but still, fuck you. That's my money and I'm not giving you any change.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. It's the practice, you know, it's the fruits, you know, it's the fruits, out of, what is it? There's one saying that, out of the evil heart, a man commits evil things, you know, or out of the good heart of man, you know, does good things. You know, people's intentions, you know, is by their deeds and how they love other people. And that's how you can tell, you know, that where, who has been, you know, in the presence of the Creator, you know, who has spent time, you know, meditating or, you know, things of that sort. And that's how you tell. That's how you can tell, you know, people who are really real about it, is because their fruits just automatically show, you know, you're kind and you love one another. You're not judging somebody or trying to cram down your belief system and down their throat, or, you know, telling them theirs is wrong. You know, when you spend that time and you just come from that presence and that peace of the true, you know, Creator of the whole world and every culture, you don't do those kinds of things. You know, you're not judging, you're not, you know, trying to correct people. You're just all about love and serving. You know, it's your ego dies.
And then we have the internet also bringing us this polarization in our society and conspiracies and all this kind of stuff. And like you mentioned a little bit about, you know, white American, the education system and all that. Is there anything, as you've been journeying and getting and growing and becoming, let's say, more of a voice for your people and more, you know, I don't know, like more popular. Is there something you would change if you could about our culture and the problems we have in it? Or do you stay away from the political system or the, cause we talk about, we get all mixed up in this in the show, right? Like, I don't even know what I don't watch the news really. So part of it I know is a distraction, but there's so much crap out there too. That's just, it's just,
I'm trying
annoying.
To get Bernie Sanders on the show.
Oh.
Right. Yeah. There's so much, you know, out there to agree with, you know, disagree with. There's just so much causes, you know, causes and things that people are putting out there, and there's a lot to see, and there's a lot of information that come before our eyes every day on Facebook and social media.
Yeah, overload.
And what moves us, you know, what moves our hearts, what moves our minds, what ignites, you know, a spark of wanting to help or wanting to be a part of it or informing others, you know, wanting to share those views or whatever they are. And I would say with the people, just, you know, I mean, it goes back to just how gossip is spread, you know, on the res. It's like, you believe everything you hear, you know, like somebody was to tell you something, you just automatic, oh, you believe that as the truth. But I would say, you know, don't believe that. I mean, go find out for yourself, you know, do research. Take the time to actually go to the root of these beliefs and these causes and find out for yourself, you know, how you, what is the truth, you know, before backing something. You know, I mean, you could see a meme, you know, like just believe it, you know, as 100% truth. It's just, I would say, just have knowledge and wisdom. You know, I would tell the people, you know, move in knowledge and wisdom. And you know, don't just be a follower of everything. You know, like, find out for yourself, you know, what's truth to you. You know, go to the source of whatever it is, and, you know, find out, you know, what it is, and make your decisions and your allegiance, I guess you could say.
Don't be cattle.
Based on those things, based on real, you know, real facts and real research.
What another big thing, I mean, that I think has been lost, that the entire world could learn from Native culture, is that respect for elders, right? Like, it seems like that's completely gone in modern society. So it seems like we're just doomed to learn the same lessons every three or four generations.
Yeah, yep, it's true. The simple Native values, you know, you see them change, you know, over the years. You see things are different. Like I was just having a conversation with my friend about powwow culture. You know, I was raised in powwow culture, and it's different. It's different nowadays. It's you know, there's a lot of honor, you know, a lot of respect. There still is that too, but I guess you could say there was more honor, more respect, you know, way back when. And nowadays you can see people, if they lose, they'll be vocal about it. You know, they're going on Facebook and bash the committee, they'll bash the powwow, and just, you know, there's no honor and no respect in that circle, you know, as much as there was. And so it's different, you know, things are different. These values that we've had, we were raised with from the old school, I guess. I'm from the old school. So these different native values, you know, that we were taught by our ancestors, to our elders, to us, is changing. You know, there's a lot of influence from the dominant society, and things are just changing. And it's definitely need new leaders, you know, to honor these values and teach these values. So, yeah, what was the question?
Hey. No, I think it was about the elders and stuff, right? Which is kind of what you're addressing there.
Yeah, yeah, and I think it's even more far gone in the white world, if you're to say it that way. Like in a place like Calgary, it's just like, you know, it's like once you hit 60, you're useless.
Really?
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm not saying that personally, but you know, that's kind of what it is. I mean, yeah. There's an old folks home every fucking...
Yeah, that's true.
Three old folks. Yeah. Yeah, exactly, right? It's just like, okay, well, I don't want to take care of you or deal with you or listen to you, so I'll just throw you at home. And
but do you think part of the problem with that is that more people have Alzheimer's and these other, like, dementia because of, like,
come on,
chemicals and stuff in our environment?
Ageist.
Like, what? No.
That's ageist.
Then, don't you think more people have that than they did when... like a generation or two ago?
I don't know. I think the big one is like...
I think so.
The
yeah.
big one is like, you know, no one even gives a shit about World War II anymore. Like, we're only two generations removed from it, and we're just about, like, we're right on the fringe of jumping right back in there again. Where if you talk to our grandparents, they would be like, you're fucking nuts if you think that's a good idea.
Yeah.
Because we lived through that.
Yep, it's different for sure.
What about
KRS-One was saying something. I heard they were talking about food, you know, like, everybody's being vegetarians, and, you know, but you eat meat, you get cancer and all of this. And he was saying he had a nice little view, you know, it was kind of, he said, I've seen indigenous people, you know, old indigenous people who are, you know, 90 years old, and they still... you know, they smoke cigarettes and they eat, you know, greasy food, eat bacon, and they're still alive. You know, he said, they're still alive. He said, it's not the food, you know, it's the respect. He said, it's the respect that they had. He said, their values. He said, they respected the animal, you know, and they were taught to respect, you know, food and to pray over their food. And that's why they can live a long life. Nowadays, people don't, you know, they don't have respect for these animals and, you know, the food that comes before them. And that's why, you know, he's like, that's why there's so much disease and you know, and cancer, is because these generations don't have that respect anymore. And that was kind of like, oh, wow, that's some knowledge, you know.
Yeah, that makes sense to me. I mean, even just having slowing down and actually focusing on your food is something I need to do a bit better. I don't even take a breath when I'm eating, and then I start hiccuping after. Like, I just got to, like, actually just slow down and actually meditate.
Chew your food 25 times.
I can't do it 25 times.
No, me neither. I get the hiccups like every third meal. My wife's always like, what are you doing? Like, what's your rush? I'm always done like way quicker than my mother. And I'm hungry again.
So how long were you said you're in the powwow culture for quite a while there. We saw a couple of videos of you dancing. That seems like quite the workout. Were you competing at a pretty high level? And have you been in that longer than you've been into your music and your other artistry?
Yeah, I've been in powwow culture, you know, way before hip hop. And I was fourth grade, I started off as a traditional hot dancer, you know, back home, so traditional dance. So I was started off in that way, you know, brought out to the circle, and we would travel around and dance. And then later on, I adopted the style of fancy dancing, you know, always wanted to be a fancy dancer. So So adopted that style, and we would travel, you know, go to powwows here, there, you know, all over Minnesota, and you know, just be a part of that. And then hip hop came later, you know, like, yeah, I used to break dance, you know, stuff like that. I love hip hop culture, but to be serious and be you know, vocal about it, be an MC, or, you know, try to be an artist about it, you know, like that came like way later. And so, yeah, powwow culture was just, you know, that was just normal life to me.
So that's interesting. Was it, what's the fancy dance is the one that you would see online with all your fancy regalia. I can't remember what you call it. What do you call that stuff, Darren? Do you know?
Headdress.
The headdress and all that?
I think that's more than a headdress.
Yeah.
Yeah, bustles and fancy regalia, fancy dance from Oklahoma.
Huh. And is that quite a, like, this powwow, like, we've talked about these other, you know, you got sweat lodges and other spiritual practices and all that. Like, if I didn't know what a powwow was, is there a spiritual meaning behind that? Is it it's sort of like drumming in altered states of consciousness or anything like that? Like, do you actually get into a meditative state while you're doing that?
Yeah. I was always taught, you know, when you come out to the circle, you need to come out with a good heart. You know, you come out to the circle, it's a spiritual, you know, dance. Like, whether... You know, fancy dancing is really contemporary. You know, it's probably one of the most contemporary dances there is. It was for show. If you know anything about the history, it was, you know, started in Oklahoma. It was for the Wild West Buffalo Bill show. And it was just for the audience. You know, it wasn't really, didn't have a really very significant, okay, you know, spiritual meaning or anything like that.
Mm-hmm.
So, but I was taught, you know, like when you come out to that circle, it's spiritual, you know, your dancing is your prayers, you know, you're dancing and there's people that are watching you out there in that circle who are sick, you know, there's people who've lost a loved one, you know, there's people who are in wheelchairs who can't dance, who wish they could dance. And so those are the people that you're dancing for, you know, so have a good heart and have a good spirit because those are your prayers, you know, for the people watching. And enjoy yourself, you know, don't come out there all mad, you know, having a bad, you know, attitude or anything like that, you know, be happy that you're alive and, you know, and just be thankful when you dance that you're able to dance. So it is, you know, it's spiritual. And these songs, you know, these singers and everything, you know, those songs are passed on and it's all, you know, one, you know, we all become, you know, just that one, you know, it is a spiritual practice. I mean, there's a lot of, it's kind of like sport now, kind of like a rodeo, you know, there's a lot of competition.
Yeah.
So there's that aspect of it nowadays, you know, where it's a lot of competition, you know, people are trying to win money and, you know, be the best and things of that sort. And that's part of it. It's good and bad, you know, it is good and bad. But I always encourage, you know, the people, the parents, to teach your kids first, you know, about what it means, you know, to come out to the circle and to put on the, you know, our feathers and put on our outfits and what it means to when the family comes together and beads for you, you know, it's that love, you know, that they have for you to bring you out and that the right that we have as natives, you know, as indigenous people to practice these ways, you know, because there's a time when we couldn't, you know, it was illegal to do this. So it's definitely, I encourage everybody to know the foundation, you know, of why we even dance, you know, what's the meaning of our dances.
Wow. Do you, you have to mention now that we're on that topic about the video, why, and your partner, she's dancing in a, what do you call that?
A rattle dress
or something like that. Can you talk about her a little bit?
Cause
she's,
dress.
I mean, she's really, she really captures you, that whole, the whole sound and the movement. It's pretty cool. Yeah,
my 4-year-old wants one now.
Yeah. Kasia, Red Up. She's amazing. You know, she's been at it for a long time, you know, dancing in the circle as well, you know, using the jingle dress style that she adopted. You know, she's from the Umatilla tribe over in Oregon, and the jingle dress style comes from the Ojibwe, Anishinaabe.
I'm Ojibwe,
people, I believe.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah. So you probably know the history of that
dance. Ojibwe Mishkigo Gaming.
Nice.
Yeah, from Northern Ontario.
What did you just say to
me? There you go.
Mishkigo Gaming. That's my band. Yeah.
So anyways, go.
So she comes from that too. You know, she comes from that history of what it means to dance. You know, she knows the power of the dance and, you know, and what it's all about. And she herself is a champion of dancing. And I asked her one time, I said, how many times have you won, you know, in a row? How many first place have you won in a row? And she said, 42 times. I was like, dang, holy smash, that's like the world record. You know, I've never heard anybody to win that much consecutively. You know, I was like, that is so amazing. And so she uses her gift, you know, in a good way. You know, she's awesome. She has a great heart, you know, for the people as well as her family. So, yeah, she was perfect, you know, for the video. I had told her, you know, a while back, I said, hey, man, I want to do a new video, you know, have you dance in there where I'm, you know, sampling and the sounds and everything. Be good if you were in that. She's like, yeah, man, just let me know, you know. And the stars kind of lined up, you know. She was in the area, and my video dude was in the area, and I was in the area at the same time. I was like, hey, we should do it right now. So we did it.
I think a lot of things lined up for that single. I'm really looking forward to the rest of the album. One thing I wanted to touch on after we kind of got off the topic, but you were talking about how the competition and money has kind of invaded the powwow scene. And that's probably where some of this, you're talking about how the ethics and the respect has kind of gone out of it. I mean, it seems anywhere that fucking money can get into, it can just ruin everything. Like any place money can weasel its way into isn't going to be as good anymore.
Yep, that's true, man. The root of all evil, man. That's straight up true. Shows its face and changes people.
Well, at least we got guys like you fighting back. I've got to say, I've been inspired myself. Me and my wife were talking about what she's wanted to for a while, but I think we're going to start getting our girls back into, well, not back into, but into the powwow scene out here. You know, even if it's just awesome. A couple times a summer, right? They both love to dance. They've got their little drums they love to beat on, and they're big. My wife raises them, and she's into the, or she raises them as on the spiritual side. Like she does her chakra meditations and teaches them their breathing and things like that.
So, yoga and stuff.
Yeah,
you bet.
I gotta get into awesome. The yoga. I can barely fucking move sometimes. Like I'm so non-flexible these days. It's really pretty embarrassing.
Are you still practicing the powwow?
I got to go to some powwows this summer. I actually just took time off from traveling, and I was like, man, I'm gonna hit some powwows, man. I've been able to dance, you know, or go out there. So I went to Rocky Boy, I went to Fort Hall and Crow Fair, and it was good to be out there and see everybody, you know, and just participate. It's dope.
Nice, yeah. And are you still living in Montana?
Yep, we live in Billings now.
Nice. And what about you're coming up with this album now called Illuminative, and can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, yep. The album is titled Illuminative. And it'll be coming out hopefully New Year's, like New Year's Day. I'm trying to push for that release there. And my last album was about almost 2 years ago now, you know, like I was telling you guys, you know, I do everything myself, you know, from the production to the recording and writing and everything. And so it usually takes me some time, you know, to put out an album, especially when I'm traveling, you know, and bringing home the bacon, you know, for the family, and just to have the time to dedicate and put out an album is always a task. So I'm happy. I'm not going to make this one like a whole lot of tracks. It's going to be at least 13 tracks, you know, not too many. And got some two good songs, you know. The first videos I've released, you know, the Prayer Loop song as well as Why, you know, they're almost at a, I don't know, Why is at a million views, and Prayer Loop song is almost at a million. So those songs will both be on there, you know, with some others. I'm excited for it because of the whole reception, you know, people embracing it and anticipating it. And that's great for me, you know, for anybody to say, hey, I can't wait for your album to come out. You know, just being underground and having a label and just doing everything yourself, it's good to get that support, you know, from people and to be able to be blessed that way, you know, financially and giving back, you know, with the album, and knowing that the album is going to be coming from that place of prayer, you know, with that tangible power upon it, you know, it's going to be on it. And that's the main thing, you know, to inspire and to bless people, you know, with the goodness in that way. And that's the most important thing. So Illuminatives, yeah, be coming out during New Year's Day, hopefully. Should be dope.
Yeah, so, and I've actually, I'm going to play a couple of tracks. I'll probably play, well, I'll play those two for sure in this episode so that you guys can hear it. And if any of you guys haven't heard it before, I'm sure everyone I've shared it with so far has been absolutely blown away.
That's
I've shared
awesome,
it with
man.
People up from the States and Mexico and not, well, Jared hasn't answered me yet over in New Zealand.
Yeah.
His new kid must be keeping him too busy.
Yeah.
But it's good. It's good to see you're getting the recognition and it's paying off. I mean, it's got to be, it had to be a tough battle, especially raising a family along the way. It must be nice to see that start paying off and, you know, not being so worried about your financial situation.
Yeah, yep, exactly. And that's another thing I learned along the journey. You know, it's like when you can, when you really think, you know, you overthink and you're just like so worried about, you know, how it's going to do and, you know, what you're going to do. You plan everything out, you know, when you just start planning everything out, those are the times it's just kind of like, you know, nothing really happens. But when you just go with it, you know, you just go with the flow, you're just happy with whatever, you know, that's when, I think that's when things happen, you know, like that's when God blesses it because he knows that you're not so worried about it, you know, you're just like, everything's all good, you know, happy-go-lucky and just when you're not expecting it is that's when things happen, you know, like, yeah. Like I put out the video. I wanted to get all these websites, you know, for the video. Why? I want to get all these websites, you know, in order and have this big old, you know, the lease and all of that. And then I was like, who cares? And I was like, okay, I'm just put it out, you know, in the evening time right now, you know, I don't even care. I just threw it out there, you know, and those are the type of things, simplicity just, and things just catch on. And then that's where that power comes from. You know, people watch it and they're compelled to want to share it with somebody. They're compelled to, you know, they can feel something, you know, on that video, on that music. That's different. You know, it's different. It's not just, oh, another rap song. You know, there's something about it. And that comes from the power of prayer, you know, of making music that way. And so when you just throw it out like that and just it takes off by itself, you know, you're at least expecting it. You know, those are the best times. You're like, yeah, I wasn't even trying. You know, I was just going with the flow.
And how's your band? Do you have a lot of support from the whole Crow Nation? Like, is it everyone's all in?
Yeah, everyone's all in. Like, we're really tight. You know, we have a clan system. You know, we're like families are really closely knit. You know, on our res, and so. And they all know me, you know, like I just grew up there. They all know who I am and what I'm about. And they always support me, whatever I do. So it's great. You know, it's great to have everybody just have your back, especially when you mesh the cultures, you know, like when you're meshing cultures and yeah. You're doing something new, you know, you're always going to catch some heck, you know, from somebody. I'm lucky to be able to, just having my heart in a good area, you know, my heart is in a good place. So when somebody says, you can't wear those feathers and do that rap music, you know, I'm just like, well, you know, it's like,
turns out
they don't know me. You know, I understand that they don't know me, you know, they don't understand of what I'm trying to do. They don't know my vision, you know, trying to reach these people. They're not there. You know, when I'm counseling a young teenager who's about to commit suicide, you know, and I just stay with them, you know, all night and, you know, they're not there to see those kinds of things. And they just see, you know, they just mark it off right away. So it doesn't bother me, you know, as much when people come against it because they just don't know. If they did, I'm pretty sure they would be like, hey, that's good, you know, because I get it from my elders. My elders are like, you know, get thumbs up, go for it, you know. Anything done with a good heart, you know, towards reaching these kids who are dying, who are committing suicide, who are on drugs, anything done with a good heart and reaching them in a good way, you know, to try to help them, that's worthy of your effort. You know, it's worth the effort. Go for it. You know, do whatever you can, you know, to reach them. Okay. So when you get that kind of backing, it just gives you an encouragement.
And I don't think that's something I don't think that a lot of mainstream culture really realizes, or even maybe a lot of our listeners may not realize, is just how big of a problem the suicide epidemic is in native life.
Yeah, for sure. It's rampant, you know, it's rampant. It's out there, man, in the Dakotas. A lot of reses are just, it's a problem. It's something that we need to fight against, all the time. And the more we can do it, the more people who are coming against that, in a good way and using whatever skills they have, in a good way to reach these people who are hurting is, man, we need more, we need more of it.
I love the way you have that acceptance around the people that are resisting you, that's, I really appreciate that. It shows that, that you have some sympathy for people that are judging you without understanding what you're really doing. So I also want to ask you about your travels. You mentioned you're traveling around lots. Are you on the road with your music as well then quite a bit? And will you take your new album on the road?
Yeah. I've been traveling for a while now. So I'm just getting ready to do some traveling here this month. And it's been crazy, trying to balance family life and pick these opportunities, that show themselves. So I've been traveling quite a bit and take some shirts on the road, got my albums and everything and being able to reach out to different reses, and different people and colleges. Like in November, I'll be going on a little college tour towards the East and kind of educating them about, walking in two worlds as a Native American, and stuff like that. It's a great opportunity and enjoy it.
Ooh, what kind of shirts you got? We should do a shirt swap.
I just got this little Supaman graffiti type with one of our chiefs from my nation on there. And so I just kind of made that. I don't really have a clothing line or anything yet. So it goes on the road, my wife is kind of handling that side of it, of merchandise online. So she's getting a website ready, to put out there.
Yeah.
We have enough inventory. It just should be dope.
Yeah, let me know. I'll pick one up for sure. Yeah, we'll send you a Grimerica shirt.
Yeah, yep, you bet, man. We'll rip that.
Any trips to Canada? You're right. You can't be more than a few hours south of the border.
Yeah, I was just over there in Banff. Is that how you say it? Banff?
Banff.
Yeah, Banff. I was over there at the Arts Theater of the Arts. We did some youth work over there. They brought in some schools and performed for them, got to speak to them.
When was that?
There's always doors opening. That was right in the beginning of the summer.
Ah, man. That's 2 hours from the igloo. Less than 2 hours from where we're sitting right now. I would have went to that for sure. That would have been good to bring my kids to.
Yeah, it was dope, man. I love that place, man. This beautiful. The whole town was real cool. It's like Aspen or something.
Yeah, it's something else. It gets real cold in the winter, though. But yeah, mm-hmm. next time you're up this way, we'll have to have you in the igloo for a chat and do this again.
Yep, you betcha. I'm down, man.
Do you have anything else you want to mention?
Before we go, we got to make sure we mention where we can track you down to, where our listeners can find more Supaman.
Yeah, for sure. You can find me online. My Twitter is at Supaman Hip Hop, and then Instagram is Billy Ills, BILLYILLS. And then my Facebook is /SupamanHipHop. What else is there? Snapchat is Billy-Ills. And then YouTube /GreasyFace. I wish I had all the, Supaman is such a common, people use it. There's a billion Superman, artists out there. And so even to have all my social media, all locked down to one. So it sucks.
even the way it's spelled, you'd think there'd be less, but yeah, when I was searching for some content on you, it's I found at least six different Supaman hip hop artists.
No, really?
Yeah. There's a bunch, man. They're all out there, but mine is the first that pops up at least, when you do a Google search or you do a Facebook search.
Yeah. Even in iTunes.
That's always the first one.
iTunes, your three albums pop up right off the bat. Oh, and your singles.
All right.
Yeah.
That's good, man. I better copyright that name before somebody does.
Is that you presenting House Deep in Ibiza? No, it's probably a different Supaman, right?
Ibiza. Is that that party island in Spain?
Yeah, that's got to be a different Supaman.
Well, I think that's about it. Did you have anything else you wanted to say before we let you go? A last message?
I had a message to tell anybody. I would just say, man, get back to the foundation, you know, whether you're native, you're non-native, man. Find out who you are, you know, what's your purpose on this earth, and serve one another. You know, I know that the way I found it, you know, was in my time of prayer. You know, when I take time and I pray, I realize what my purpose is, you know, to serve others, is to be, you know, loving and kind, you know, to one another, to my family. And when you're in that time, you know, that's where it's at. You know, your peace and your journey on this earth becomes more real. You know, you become more real and you're able to, you know, live life to the fullest. So I encourage anybody out there, you know, going through anything, going through a hard time, or whatever it is, you know, it'll pass. You know, go to the Creator, you know, ask for help, and rise up, you know, above all your obstacles in life. Go forward, make it happen.
Well said, man. Thanks for your honesty, and it's been just an amazing chat.
I do have a last minute question from the chat.
Oh, yeah, of course, no problem. Well, I say no problem. But
are you going to Denver anytime soon?
Denver, they just hit me up for Denver March Powwow, which is in March. March time, I think around the 18th, 19th. So probably be over there. As far as any other gigs, that's the only one that I can think of.
So there you go, Bart. He will be there in March, and maybe you'll get a show.
Nice.
He says that's Calgary's sister city. I've heard that before, actually.
That's why I think there's an underground tunnel from the new airport to the Denver airport. I don't want to get all conspiratorial.
There you go.
But
yeah, there's Grimes off in his own little world. Well, actually, maybe one last question. I wonder, is there if there's a place in Native mythology for a term like synchronicity? Have you ever come across that?
Synchronicity? Well, not like in ours, but I've heard of that, you know, where things just, you're on point, you know, you just write where you're supposed to be, you know. I try to walk in that every day.
Nice. Yeah, that's a good way to put it.
Have you experienced any little synchronicities, like any little meaningful coincidences along your journey, especially over the last few years when you've started to integrate more and you've been sort of taking off?
Oh yeah, there's like too many, you know, to say. Oh, like even this one, you know, I was like thinking about bringing I'll share this one just real quick. I was thinking about bringing a young guy, you know, with me, like try to mentor, you know, somebody who's Crow, you know, who's from the same tribe as me, and try to be an inspiration to them, you know. And so I was thinking of doing that, and then kind of like my pride was like, I don't know. There was a certain individual, and I was like, you know, he was kind of like having a struggle with alcohol, you know, and stuff like that. And in my mind, I'm like, I don't want to deal with that, you know. He needs to get right, you know, before I even try to work with him. And it's just going to be a bad co-sign. You know, I can't co-sign somebody who's all, you know, struggling with stuff. And so that was in my mind. My ego was saying that. But then in prayer time, when I was having prayer time, and I felt like, you know, that I needed to reach out to him. But then the part of me was like, I'm not going to deal with that. You know, I'm not going to mess around with that. And then right when I jumped on Facebook, bam, he like inboxed me from out of nowhere. Like I never talked to the dude ever. And he like inboxed me and just like, hey, what's up, bro? I just want to say you're inspiration, you know, to my life. And I was like, what the heck? I was like, this is crazy, you know? And so I knew that I had to take this guy, you know, and take him along some shows. And so that was just like, you kind of know, you know, like you're right there, and you know, that's the way it's supposed to be. So that's just one story.
Huh, that could be the highest rating ever.
That's a pretty good one. I love it.
I'll give it a 9.9. Yeah.
Darren likes to, Darren likes to rate all.
Yeah,
this,
that's so. Just one, man. I could tell you like so many, but yeah, that's one, man. I feel blessed to be able to recognize those, you know,
exactly.
Like recognize those things.
That's funny.
Like that. You just gotta be open the mind and open the ears.
That's funny because we get to, no matter what we're talking about, whether it's someone researching a book or a musician or an artist or novelist, all that, it always seems to be the same answer. It's like when those start coming around and you start really looking for them, then that's, you know, kind of when you are where you're supposed to be.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. Exactly. Deja vu stuff.
Right on, man. Thanks so much. That was a great story.
Yeah. Thanks for coming on the show. Thanks for sharing your story. Again, we encourage our listeners to check it out. And yeah, awesome. It's been an awesome time. Thanks for coming. Come back anytime.
Yeah, you bet. Thank you, brothers, man, for having me. It's an honor and a privilege, you know, to be able to speak. And you guys have a blessed night.
Right on, man. Thanks. We'll send you a link to the show as well.
All right. Sounds okay, good, buddy. Brothers.
All right. Take care, man.
Bye.
Bye.
All right. Take care. Later. Yeah.
Say what, say what, say what, say what. Yeah. Yo, I like to rhyme well and watch Seinfeld. I get a kick out of getting kicked by a Clydesdale. Cause you never know what Superman's planning. I took my blind friend to the Grand Canyon. We all fall, yo, but I never rap evil. You might catch me skinny dipping with some fat people. To all the MCs I know why, yo, they used to bust. Take my advice, cause I don't use it much. With supers in the clutch, they give me respect. And don't forget to buy the CD with your lease check. You know we bless underground rap sounds. Never go belly up, cause I never back down. Masquerade champ, they know me by my hairy legs. A hustler, selling Avon and Mary Kay. The Christ life, you're right, there's none iller. You can go hard, but I'm a gorilla.
I'm a gorilla, 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 gorilla. I'm a gorilla, 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 gorilla. I'm a gorilla, 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 gorilla. You can go hard.
That was our chat with Chris, a.k.a. Superman. What'd you think, buddy?
It was great. What a nice guy, yeah.
Yeah, it was.
Everyone, thank him lots for coming on.
Yeah, super humble, super smart guy.
I love this.
A powerful message.
I meant to say to him to make sure he keeps his positivity. I love that, like how he's not resentful to what's going on. Like, he's just like, look, like some of our other guests, be loving and kind and compassionate. And just, you know, accept that, right? I like it.
Yeah, help each other out.
Yeah.
Spread the good word.
Yeah, I'm surprised we didn't get into, like, addiction alcohol a little bit more. We want to sort of talk to him a little bit more about that as well, but...
We ran out of time.
Yeah, no, it was really good, though.
Yeah, one for the books, I think, for sure. I think we'll get a real good reception on that one. Hope you guys enjoyed it. I know I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I think he's onto something with mixing his native lyrics, like not just the message, like you said the other day or earlier about his metaphor being in the songs, but now he's like actually using the language, and I think it's a really good mix.
Yeah. Yeah, well, he was talking about all the little celebrity shout-outs that are starting to happen, right? Like, that's how it happens.
Yeah.
And bam, a million views. Like, I think his first video took a while to get a million views. Now this next one's been like less than a month. Just bam.
Yeah.
So hopefully he continues to grow. Hopefully you guys enjoyed the tunes we played on this episode. Of course, you can find him on iTunes. You can buy all his stuff on iTunes. Or you can...
you can go to all of the Reverb Nation. There's all kinds of stuff there.
Yeah, his Twitter, a lot of it's on YouTube. It's all on YouTube.
iTunes, yeah. Oh, you just said that.
I said iTunes, yeah. While you're on iTunes, pop by the Grimerica Show, leave a review.
Yeah.
And yeah, absolutely, check out the album. If you enjoyed the songs, I think most of our listeners probably enjoyed the tracks. We'd like to thank him, of course. Thanks for letting us play them. For you guys to enjoy. And yeah.
Yeah, we love getting your emails, so don't send emails to graham@grimerica.com with your experiences or your feedback or just to say hi.
Don't stop spamming, Graham.
If I don't reply, please, you can always remind me, but
Just keep sending it.
No, just some stuff slips through the cracks, but we do read them all for sure.
Plug up the cracks, Graham.
Yeah.
Plug them up. Yeah, thanks for sending in your stuff. As always, you can head over to grimerica.ca/support and check out all the different options we have there to... help keep us 100% listener supported, ad free, sponsor free, paywall free, everything for free. You guys enjoy it and you pay us as you see fit. And then while you're at the website, actually check out the blogs. We got a couple new bloggers. The blog the blog space at Grimerica has really expanded. We got Napoleon doing his web comic and quite a few blogs coming out there now. So we thank everyone for that, all our bloggers. And saying that, head over, shoot me an email, shoot Graham an email if you're interested in blogging. We're always looking for bloggers or artists or web comics or whatever. Grimerica is a community to us, not just our podcast. So we want to make it as much about sharing your guys' stuff as you guys listening to our lazy ramblings.
You bet.
Thanks for listening, guys. Big thanks to Supaman for coming on. And we will see you guys next week. Was this a bonus app? Well, you're getting an extra app here the next week or two anyway, so you're welcome. See you next week, or in a couple days, or last week.
Drop the kids off and go party gets me mad. So I pray, pray for peace, to pray for change. Keep on praying when everything stays the same. And I pray for the pastors and all of the churches and those who cry night song following hearses. I pray for you, pray for the sick and the poor. Pray for the rich man who don't give to the Lord. And I pray for wisdom and I pray for power. And I pray for be ready in the final hour. And I pray for those who keep judging ministry. And I pray for my friends and my enemies. Somebody help me up.
I'm a rambling gram with synchronicities all over the web. And Darren is skeptical about everyone and don't believe it yet.
And now for some authentic Native American music. As I'm playing this song here, I want you all to think about what you're thankful for in this life, all right?